I'm going to do a quick demo of character animation tools in Blender. So bear with me as I navigate this. Oh, here we go. So the object is to review the character animation tools in Blender and see how they work. I'll be focusing on the use of armatures, obviously with meshes. There are a lot of other tools available in Blender that could help in character animation, but because that's not their focus, that's not really what I'm talking about. For character animation, you basically start with a big mesh. How you get that mesh attached to an Okay, so we have a little
I'm just trying to figure out how to use a middle mouse button here. Just trying to get the situation.
To select the bone, you just select its root and its tail,
And if you don't want that behavior, if you don't want any change, you just unselect this IK button, and now those two points are independent. The chain is useful when you go into pose mode. For instance, let me just delete this action here. Kill everything, I think. You can add, let's just make a very short chain. And I'll snap the cursor here. I'm going to add, just for a step, I'm going to add another one here. And for IK to actually work, you need to have these bones in a chain like this. And actually, to do IK, you have to apply a constraint onto the childmost bone in the chain. So you just go into the object buttons here, you add a constraint, and you pick the IK solver, and you have to have the bone solver for that. And so for the object, you type in the name of the object, which is displayed here as armature. And then you get the option to type in which bone in that armature you have as a target. And so I'm going to do bone.03. And you notice that this bone is down to this one, and the whole chain is following it automatically. If I grab this around, which one?
Oh,
that's how it works. And in this armature, that's how you want to do feet. I can zoom in. So the feet are IK targets. And you can't see anything happening here because I don't have enough parameters. So let me show you another option. So it's going to go into edit mode. On this mesh, on this armature, you see a lot more bones than show up normally. That's because one of the other options is to hide bones. You can do it two ways. You can go into edit mode and select a bone, and you notice you have a hide button here. Now, nothing happens in edit mode, but when you get out, you don't see it anymore. The other way you do it is by there's two modes that you can be in. You can be in edit mode, where you're creating your skeleton, and you can be in this mode, which you get by hitting Control Tab, which is for pose mode, and that's when you're actually making poses on your skeleton. You can also hide bones in this mode by selecting them and hitting H for hide. I don't think there's a way of getting it back while you're in pose mode. You have to go into edit mode to get it back after that, I think. So that you can unhide it here. It unhides everything though, right?
Mm-hmm.
Right, so not just a specific zone. So let's try that.
But if you were trying to hide constraint, why would it not work on the tip? Why would the root of the bone flip to
another? Well, the tip, you can think of as sort of a null. It's the IK null at the very end of the chain. It's not really part of the chain exactly, but it's what influences it all around. And I don't know if it's the best way to do it. It's just the way that Blender does it, and that's what I'm used to. If you want to use the tip, you can sort of make the tip behave with the rest of the chain by adding another constraint to it. If this tip was actually a bone that had geometry attached to it and you were interested in its rotation, you can add another constraint, copy rotation, and just to the same bone, the same IK target bone. And now the tip is sort of, it's like the rest of the chain. It doesn't, its rotation follows the weighted rotation of the resolver.
It's
so,
a long bone.
Sure. You notice that when you have an IK chain and you pull the goal away too far, the chain just sort of stretches as far as it can to sort of try to reach it, but it'll never actually break anywhere in between. So it just sort of points at it until you touch it. And sometimes when you're animating, you can make ugly pops by pulling an IK solver too far and have it hit it, and it has that sort of moment of sort of near jerk that happens in the animation. So sometimes you're getting lots of pops because you're pulling your target stuff too far. If you go back to this armature here, I'm going to go ahead and unhide all the bones in it so you can see what they're doing. So this foot bone here is an IK solver for that chain, and you'll notice how you can pick up the feet and the whole leg will move naturally, which is nice. The other thing that's nice about it is you can grab the sort of this root bone down here, which is apparent to the feet, and you can move it around, and you notice the feet stay locked in place, even though the legs sort of do a natural motion to sort of meet their targets at the end. And this is nice because when you're animating, you want to try to isolate different parts of your leg apart from each other. So you can make a change in one place and not have it sort of propagate through. If you had to animate the leg in FK, which is forward kinematics, which is like how the arms are done here, and let's say you rotated this, and you rotated this, and you got it exactly where you got the hand exactly where you want it, and then you said, okay, but I want to do something. I want to, you know, I don't like where the root is. I'm going to move it, but I'm going to move with it now. And so, if you had feet trying to stay on the ground, and you move the whole thing, the feet would just go all over the place, which isn't nice. This rig is built pretty much the same way as that example skeleton was built. And it has a whole bunch of constraints on it, but it's not too complicated. It's got these, you can see that there's a small bone inside here. And that small bone is the actual foot IK target that's at the no bone at the end. And it just has. And the other ones going up here. These pointing away ones, I'll get to them. So that gives you control over the foot, right? And I wanted to have also control over the knee. So what I did is. The IK target has a child, and Blender draws these dotted lines between bones and their parents, so you can see the parenting relationship. So this moves with this, and this bone here is an IK solver for this bone here. There's another IK constraint on the chain, on the second bone in the chain. And so this bone is trying to get to this one. It'll never make it, and will always stay as part of the chain, but the result is that the knee is going to point here. And so you have a bone which allows the knee to get aimed. And so that's really what that is for. Usually, you don't need to play with it that much, actually. But every now and then, you get into weird pose, you don't look like the way the knee looks, or it bends the wrong way.
Does it also restrict the knee from bending backwards?
Yeah, exactly. If you get into a funny position where the knee wants to bend the wrong way, you can pull it out the right way using the skeleton. So it is a helpful one.
How do you find where the oxygen is from?
Where?
But I don't understand the question. I understand where IK starts and it ends.
But IK is a set. So it starts with the first call and the second call.
Yeah. It goes all the way up the chain. So if you have an unbroken IK chain, which is, if this is a chain of bones, and let's say this is the little, I'll make him at an angle, this little null bed, and you apply an IK constraint to this guy, it's going to propagate all the way down this chain. So long as there's a parent-child relationship, and so long as the IK button is pressed here, here, it's going to propagate. If you don't want it to propagate, you can uncheck this button, and now it will stop here. So that's how you can control how high up the chain it goes. Does that answer the question?
And when I carry it before,
yeah.
Somehow it stops at the head.
So yes, because there's a continuous chain that only reaches so far, and it only reaches, it's only the legs, actually. So let me try to now. So let me select this guy. So yeah, you can see that the legs. You can see the legs. I'm trying to select it right now, right? Is not connected to anything else. So it's these, you know, it defines the bottom of that chain. Another thing that I think is cool, but it's not really a good solution for every problem. For instance, you could make an IK chain out of the spine, but I don't think it would give you a good degree of control over spine curvature. I don't think it would be the best way to do it. And what I find is the simplest way to do spine curvature is to have very few bones, and they're not in an IK chain, and they're not really in FK chain at all either. I'm going to zoom in on them a little bit. You can see that, and it's complicated by the fact that I have the root bone upside down, there's a reason for that. You can see that they each have this little bone sticking out here. And basically this little bone is a child of the segment that's underneath it. And this, and you can notice there's no dotted line being drawn. And so the upper back is not a child to the lower back in this case. It's done via constraints. If you look at it here, you'll notice that it has a copy location constraint, and it's going to this mid-back dot null bone, which is this little bone right here. So it moves the upper back to where the tip of the lower back is. But the nice thing is that it doesn't affect the rotation of it. And so I can rotate the upper back, and it rotates. But you notice how the neck stays at the same angle, the head stays at the same angle. And if I rotate the lower back, the upper back doesn't rotate either. And the nice thing about that is that you want to isolate your motions to be as local as possible. You can isolate or automate, basically, and I've chosen to isolate because that means that you can put something at an angle you like and go change something somewhere else in your model when you're posing it, and it won't change the thing that you already did. So it kind of helps preserve your posing, so you don't have to do things in a certain order, you just do it when you feel like it. So you move the back a certain way, you make your head look at something specific, and then you come back and you say, oh, I changed my mind, I want to have it work differently than that. So you just go ahead and do it. There's no problem with that. I have a whole bunch of copies of the same match. Just to sort of show things like that. So, because this is actually rigged up, I'm going to do that right now. So, let's just zoom in on this. So, you can take the lower back, rotate it, and it doesn't affect the upper back. You give him a little hip wiggle there, and then you can make him his head look up like this. And rotate around. You can do funky stuff as long as you want. And see, I say it like this, and let's say I decide to wiggle the hip again. It's okay. His head's still going to point in the same angle. But if I want to like modify the angle of his upper back hip, of his shoulders a little bit. Even his shoulders are raised fairly much in the same way. They have this bone that controls the overall rotation of the shoulders, so it can work in two together. And then they each have a little shoulder bone that I can rotate by itself. Or more control in this case. So you can actually move the shoulders together as a unit or move them by themselves. And the angle of the shoulder doesn't have to be affected by the angle of the spine. So let's just go to the front of you to demonstrate that. So you can go to see how the shoulders are like that. You don't actually change angle. And then you can change the angle of the shoulders. The arms, you notice arm movement, because the arms are set up as full left hand in this case. And it's just a choice that I made. There's no real right way to lift something. It's kind of like you decide how you want to set it up to achieve the things you want to do. Other people have different philosophies and set things up totally differently than this. So this is just a very simple one. You'll notice that all the bones are pointing the same way here, and that's how I initially conceived of this rig. And what I didn't like about it was that if I wanted to wiggle his hips, let's go to the back view for effect here. So I wanted to wiggle the character's hip, they could, the whole upper body moved with it. And that was okay, but later on I thought it would be nice if I could make those two independent. And so all I did in this armature was I flipped the direction of that bone, so it points down instead of up. So now I can rotate it, and it doesn't affect the top bone sort of motion at all. So I get a much nicer capability of controlling the hip. And I can still move it, and because it's the root of all these bones, the root of all evil here, it will move them around so the upper body will move as a unit. So I have some degree of control over here. Unfortunately, I didn't think about it before I set up this demo. So most of the actions that you'll see can here involve the other setup. So moving beyond like rigging, the next step is attaching the mesh to the armature. And by the way, I like to model things so that there's no rotations on these objects. You know, if you do Alt-R, nothing changes. Because I don't like nasty surprises by having some rotation stacked up. And sometimes people get into those positions, you know, and it's hard to predict when it will make a problem, but it might. So when you're done modeling, when you're done making your armatures, you can do Control-A, which is apply a size and rotation, so it won't actually rotate on you. And I like to have things facing forward, so you know, their left is, you know, on their left and right and stuff like that. Okay, go ignore that right now.
Why is that?
Because I was mirror modeling and I forgot to do that step. Yeah. But it's not really hurting me in this case, so we're going to do this. So you just select the mesh, and you, with the shift key, you select the armature, and you do control P. It's normal parenting, and you get this choice. And in this case, you want to pick the middle option, which is armature. And I've already created vertex groups, so I'm not going to create them. I'm going to say don't create groups, but I'll talk about that in a second. And so now you see that the mesh is controlled for the armature. Now that looks a little bit like magic, and it is, because that's not exactly how it's going to go when you take a fresh mesh. And parent it. It's not going to look like that. The reason it looks so great is that this mesh already has vertex groups with weights painted on it. And I'll just show you, it'll take too long to do a good way of painting job on it. But I'll just show you how to do it. And I'm going to use, well, I won't use a new feature. We'll stay with the current release Blender has. If you go into weight paint mode, you'll see that the whole thing turns blue, and that some of it is colored. And that's because you go into these buttons, edit buttons, you'll notice these vertex groups. And so it has named vertex groups, and each of these vertex groups has the same exact name as the bones in this armature. I'm going to bump out of this mode for a second, select the armature, and to draw names so we can see the names of the bones. Incidentally, to make the names for the bones not be the default, in edit mode, when a bone is selected, you have a field here, a text button with its name, and you can edit that text button and change its name to wherever you want. None of the names are really special, except the right and left, or R and L suffixes, which are used in the program, I believe, for copying narrative poses, as well as there might be a way of flipping an armature automatically and have it do the left-right names, but I remember something like this, but I forget how to do it. So I manually renamed lowarm.r to lowarm.l when I copied it. But I think this is actually going to happen automatically. Someone else can tell us. But it is useful when you're doing poses because you can pose the model in a certain way and you can copy that pose. I'll show you how to do that in a minute. And then you can paste that pose mirrored. So everything that happened on the dot L side will happen on the dot R side instead, and vice versa. And the bones that don't have those names will just change their orientation left, right. So it's kind of a nice way of quickly getting mirrored poses out of the armature. So the vertex groups you have to create. And the old way was you had to create them by hand, and you had to retype in the name of the bones to match it. But since more recent versions, when you actually do the parenting, give you the options to create those groups. And so when I do this parenting here, I have the options to create either name groups or create composite bones. And what that means is, the name group option just creates the vertex group's names, but doesn't actually assign any vertexes to them. And so you can do your own assignment by hand. The last option will sort of attempt to see what bones are closest to those vertices and give them more influence. And so it's an attempt to create like an auto-skinning system. And it works as a first pass. So if you have created a mesh from scratch and it has no vertex groups, you can do create from closest bones, and as a first pass, it'll be okay, but you'll realize it's not deforming quite right, typically, unless you're really lucky and the shape of the mesh is almost exactly the shape of the bones, which doesn't happen too often. So for instance, if it's creating from closest bones, and you have a character whose ear is dangling down close to their shoulders, then the tips of the ears will become parented to the shoulders. And as he moves his shoulders around, his ears will start stretching, which is not what you want. So that's kind of the type of things that you'll see from the automatic creation. So you can go in and you can assign vertices to vertex groups in two ways. One way is to just go into edit mode onto the mesh and select the vertices in question. And if you go to the, I keep on expecting the middle mouse button to work. If you go into the vertex group section, you'll see there's an assign a button, and that will assign these points to this group. Actually, let me just make a little demo mesh so we can see something really quick. I'm going to add a queue. Let's just see if it's going to be. Okay. So I can go into here and see there's no vertex groups right now. I can create a new one with this button. I can name it anything I want, like bone.001, for instance. And that's, you know, matching the name of the bone. Now I can assign points to it by selecting them and then just clicking the assign button here, which puts these two bones in that group. And now if I deselect everything and I select that group, it'll select those two vertices again. If I don't want them to be in there, I can click the remove button. There's a weight here, and so right now I'm adding things with weight 1. The weight governs how much that vertex group really controls a specific vertex. Now, if there are no other groups sharing points with it, then it will control it 100%. But if two groups, you can create two groups, you can add another group, the new one, and assign, let's say, an overlapping selection. This point which belongs to the first group and this new point here. And so now these groups both control this point with weight 1, which means that it will blend 50-50 if you had bones. So if you want one group to influence them more than the other, you play with the weights when you assign it. So if I want less influence from group, I can lower the weight and assign it here and, you know, go to bone 1 and vice versa. That's kind of a slow way to do things. Another way you can assign vertices to groups is to knock out of this mode here and go from this menu here into the weight paint mode. And now when I select a group, the points that are assigned to it with the power of 1 get colored red. And there's sort of this, rainbow of influence that happens here. And it is pretty much like an RGB color blend. And so the lower the influence of the group on the vertex, the closer is the color going to go to blue, which is 0. So red is 1 and blue is 0. And I can use this weight value here, and I can just change it with a slider, and I can just paint directly on my mesh influence from a group. So I can change the influence of those vertex groups. And so that's weight painting, basically. That's all it is. And, you know, it just, you know, you can go around your model painting influences. Then take that and parent it to an armature. I won't create groups in this name. You'll notice these two points that have the name bone.001 are now controlled by bone.001, and they'll move with it. Obviously, it's so far away in this case that it's doing bizarre kinds of things, but you can sort of see the idea of it. And group isn't doing anything right now. It doesn't hurt, and it doesn't help, because it doesn't have the same name as any of the bones. If I change the name of the group to something like bone.002, you'll see that that will influence it. So now, it's really not good. So that was just a quick demo of how weight painting and assigning points to groups works. And it's much easier if you don't create the groups by hand, if you just let it create them automatically when you're assigning the armature. Whether the auto-assignment of weights helps or hinders, it's kind of 50-50. Most of the bones will be a good thing, and some of them will do something that you really didn't want, because the bone is actually very far from the points that you really wanted it to influence, or it's too close to the wrong points, or something like that. And you'll have to play with the weights, or you can go into edit mode and manually assign or remove vertices from the group. Hey, the scroll button works. Yeah, it's this. kind of a crucifixion pose we've got here. And I usually...
Also, also how we start Africa, our right foot.
Yes, exactly. The rest pose of the mesh and the rest pose of the skeleton should be the same, or you're going to have a very difficult situation on your hands. And I think, and I've observed, and I don't know the math behind it, so, oh, excuse me, sorry.
Question about the painting. Can you delete
yes.
weights by painting?
You just set the weight to zero, and you paint with that weight.
Okay.
And that's how you delete. There's a cool feature in the CBS version of Blender, which I'm going to try. In the object mode view, there's this nice, very, very nice outline of view. And thanks, Tom, by the way. So, let's see. Oh, I just killed it. Okay, here it is. So, let's just find that. So we can see the mesh that I have selected here. It's this cube mesh. And I can expand it here. And see this vertex groups. Expand that. And you can see all these vertex groups here. And the next version of Blender will make weight painting a little nicer. Because you can go into weight paint and just select like that. And have your different vertex groups selected. And if it changes to like the buttons window, and I can see my weight here, so I can start doing crazy things like, you know, select this and start painting all over the mesh and making it and, you know, doing all sorts of fun. So that's, you know, weight painting. And yes, to delete, for instance, let me select the hand and let's say I start getting a little nutty and I want to paint influence on the hand bone on the top of the head here. And notice the head does that now because it's starting to move with the hand. See, it gets worse with each implementation. And if I go and pull this weight down to zero, I can undo, I can delete that influence that I just added and make the head go back to normal. So that's basically going back to default poses, I'm pretty sure that the algorithm in Blender uses the initial angle that the bones are at to sort of see what preferential direction they'll bend at. So generally when I create my armatures, I give them a slight bend. So in, even in rest mode, the knee is slightly bent in the angle that I want it to move. That's so that it will tend to bend in that direction as the foot moves backwards, because it's already bent that way. Now, you don't actually have to make your mesh conform to this. You can make the angle very slight, and you can actually model straight down if you want to. Or you can also bend the mesh to match the bend of the knee. It's easier to model in sort of a straight XY direction than modeling on an incline sometimes for things that look like tubes, like arms and legs. So it's basically up to you if you want to match it exactly or not. So that's basically it for talking about the rigging. This armature is a very simple one actually that I'm going to use for this demo. The next thing talk about is to talk about actions. Now that you have this armature, you can do cool things with it. For instance, you can go into pose mode and you can start posing it. Pose mode, you can either you can select it from the menu down here that you can see on your screen, so it's better than doing shortcuts. And it colors the armature in blue. And you can select bones by clicking on them in this mode, by right-clicking on them. And as you do that, they turn into a brighter color, so you know what you have selected. And you can, if you click and drag, by the way, in Blender, it'll do like a default action. And if you click and drag on these bones that are in an IK hierarchy, they will start rotating immediately. So you can just do this, and it'll start rotating for you in one action. It's very handy. You can also move. So if you have a free bone like this one, and you drag it, it will start moving with you. Or you can use the G and R keys, same as you normally would. You can also scale bones by hitting the S key, and you can make things more natural. And that's not so crazy as it looks. There are reasons why you might want to do that. Perhaps you don't have much. In this case, I'm not going to be scaling anything much around. So you can make these nice poses, and to animate, you just have to key the positions of the bones. So if you go down here and look at an iPhone curve editor, and we're going to, I'll tell you why we have to do this, go into action view, you can see that there are keys on this bone. And so what we did to do this animation, we can visualize these keys in another way if you go into the action editor. And the action editor right here shows you a group of keys you can see on the left hand of the screen there are these channels that have the same base of, they are represent the bones that you are animating, and there are these little symbols along the line of the channel that represent the keyframes in time. This horizontal axis represents time here. And so you can take this, you can slide the timeline around, and you can start creating a pose, and you can start keying it, and you can make an action that way. What I'm going to do is I'm going to add a new action so I don't damage the one I already have. And so let's say if I go to this pose here, this point in time here, and I want the arm out here, I can rotate it with the I key, and I get the choice of what kind of key I want to make. I want to make a rotation key in this case. And so now, when it goes through to that point in time, the arm is going to slip out like that. So that was just a... So let's run that action by. So that's basically... how you create an action. And so why would you want to actually encapsulate the keyframes into this action object, which you can name and you can have a bunch of like this, is that these actions you can treat as part of your character's library. You can make one action that is a rock, and one action that is a hand-waving action, and so on and so forth. And you can save those. When you create an action, I don't know how familiar you are with the system in Blender, but you'll notice that it has this button here that represents how many users the data has. And you'll notice that it has two users. The reason it has two, and it should have just one, which is the armature that you'll have the action applying to. The reason it has two is that if you delete the link to it, it will still have one user left. And if you save the file and go do something else and then come back another day and open that file, the action is still there in your file because it has more than one user. And that lets you make a library of actions, even if you don't use them all at the same time, that you can just apply whenever you want to the armature. And you can take those actions, the final step, sort of, is to go into the NLA, which is the nonlinear animation editor, and the NLA is this window, this icon symbol here that Stan or someone made very recently. Very nice, thank you. And it's just one of the window types. And if you pull it up, you can see that you have an armature here that has a bunch of actions on it. These are actions, but these aren't really the actions themselves. These are strips on the NLA that use that particular action. And if you hit the N key,
you can see this little pop-up window, floating panel here, that pops up and tells you information about it. It'll tell you that this strip starts in the NLA timeline, this horizontal timeline here, at frame 1, and it ends at frame 130. It's based on an action, which is of the same name, Walk That Sassy, and the action starts at 1 and ends at 41. And so you'll notice also that it has the use path button pressed, and I'll come back to that later on. So the strip duration and the action duration don't have to match. And you can have an action that you created from frame 1 to frame 30 and plop it into the NLA later on, start it at frame 45 and end it at frame 275 and switch out to fill those frames. And so it'll play slower or faster than you did it, and it'll play at a later time. And you can have multiple strips like that that you can mix all together. So you can mix all these actions together in the NLA. I'll show you briefly the result of this NLA animation. Is this little guy is going to perform a bunch of actions. And it plays back a little bit slowly. It plays a little bit faster on my computer. But my computer doesn't really work over the projector, which is why I don't know that. And so he goes to this run. And hopefully, if I have time, I'll try to dissect this and show you every step that's needed to take something and make something like this kind of animation using that. So. So, this is actually very easy to do. That's kind of interesting is that we have this path and the character is moving along this path. And the cool thing about actions in the NLA is you can use a path, you can parent the object to the path, and it will apply the action along the motion of the object along that path. And there's another concept that comes into play here, which is called stride length. And basically what it means is if you type in the length of the stride that the motion is taking, if it's a footstep and it's moving one blender unit with each step, if you type that stride length in, that one blender unit, and you've done your actions right, then when it applies the motion to the path, you'll get no foot slipping whatsoever. It'll take the right number of steps to get from start to finish along that path. Now, the object center will move linearly, but the armature will move the way the action tells it to move. Applied along the path. Right. And so the walk cycle, when you create it, you kind of pretend that your path is walking on a treadmill. It's walking in space, in place. And you do that walk cycle with the character moving in one spot. So let's just go into... so I'm just going to change the layer. And I'm actually going to delete one of these two guys. But it doesn't work. It just looks like it works. Cool. Okay. I'm just going to delete this guy for now. So I'm just going to take this to make it easier to work on this action. I'm just going to have the front view and the side view. Both. like the armature, you'll see that I was over here. So you'll see the keys that are in the walk slide on. And a neat thing that you can see here is these sort of marching cubes. Well, they're not marching cubes, they're just moving cubes. Marching cubes is something else. It doesn't mean this. You'll see that there's these cubes in the bottom, and the cubes help me visualize that treadmill, because if I can't see it by eye, I have less of an easy time doing that animation. And some other programs can automatically put a ruler in that moves like a treadmill when you're doing your walk cycle, so that you can sort of visualize it without having to do anything. But it's easy to make. Let me go into something when creating an action soon, and we'll see how it's done. So you can see that the feet are stepping from point to point along this in the action. And to show you sort of a front scratch kind of thing, I'll delete the link to this action. And he still has that pose, but you'll notice that my character is not moving anymore. And I'm gonna, stop myself from cheating even further by putting him, taking away all the rotations, and Alt R clears rotation, and Alt G clears rotation. So now he's in his default pose again. And I'm going to do add new in the action. So create a new action. We'll call it demo action. And let's say that we want to make some kind of walk cycle or something like that. Well, let's see. So how would I go about doing that? Well, to make a walk cycle, I'm just going to do this thing where I just do key poses in the action. So some of the frames are key frames in the action, and they represent either extremes of action, or they represent some kind of interesting position within the action that people want to see. And I'll just add keys at the keyframes right now. So I'll just go into pose mode, and I'll say that I want my first keyframe to be the contact position, where both legs are in contact with the ground, and one leg is in front of the other as you walk on. So I'll just drag one leg back, and you can constrain your motion by hitting the middle mouse button. And, oh, but I can't hit the middle mouse button, sorry. You can control your motion by hitting the middle mouse button, which in my case is Alt. Okay, so Alt right button is, Alt left button is working in this mouse. So middle mouse button normally will constrain it to the axis you've already moved it in most. So if you move something mostly on the x-axis, and hit the middle button, it will just move on the x-axis. So I'm just going to slide 1 foot back, and I'm going to hit the I key, and I'm going to say I want to have a location and rotation key. And I'm going to grab this guy, and constrain it and slide it forward just a little bit. And so you notice in the action window here, I have two new channels by virtue of having keyframed two bones. I have two new channels and I have two keys in them. I'm actually going to go out of action window here, and I'm going to go into the ICO curve editor, where you can see function curves. And instead of object curves, I want to see action curves. And now, when I select a bone, I can see the curves that relate to that bone. Right now, there's nothing interesting going on in terms of curves because there's only one keyframe there. So going back, we're still in the same pose. Okay, so let's say I want the whole body to be a little bit lower at that contact pose. So maybe I'll make it this much lower. Location, rotation on this guy. And well, I don't really want the arms sticking out like this, so I'll just rotate them down. Once again, if you click select drag,
then it'll do the rotation automatically and I won't have to hit R to rotate. So I can go, and it's rotating right away, which is a time saver. And so now I go to this view and I say, okay, I want, so
excuse me, store the keyframe of my figure.
You can, I think you can set it to do automatic keyframe storing, but I think they'll get in the, like, I hear that often described as a beginner helper, but I find that it might be really painful if you're always keyframing whenever you move something. You might end up with a whole bunch of keys that you have to now go and delete. Whereas this way, you only create a key when you want to. So you can play around, do a lot of stuff, and say, okay, I want to key this one because it's nice. I want to keep them both. Yeah. Otherwise, it would create right away. So going here, into this view, I want the arm that's associated with the leg that's in front to be slightly backwards. I'll give it a slight backwards rotation like that. And I'm going to key its rotation. And since this bone only rotates, I never need to key its location. I can only key its rotation. I'll make the curves, the number of curves that I see in the curve editor a little bit less. And I'll do the same for the other arm. But this arm I will rotate a little bit forward. So we can do other things, you know, we can go, we can say, okay, I want, you know, you want to shift the body into one leg or the other, you want to rotate it maybe a little bit, and, you know, so on and so forth, and you might, you would probably end up, realistically, if you're doing a decent walk cycle, nothing quick, you'll probably end up keying all of the bones that are visible here. Because you don't really want big chunks of the body to sort of stay static all the time. It's going to give it a little bit of a dead look. But I want to do something quick right now, so I'm going to make a few changes for this particular animation. I'm not going to move his hands or his forearms independently. I'm just going to treat his arms as one unit right now, just to make a quick cycle. So now we have one pose, and that's not really much of a walk cycle yet.
Excuse me, can you slide the slider?
Yeah, you just left click on it and jump. The little cubes are moving?
Yeah.
Yeah, because they had a key on that.
And what race did you make the cubes?
You know, I'm going to delete this particular cube object and make a new one in a minute.
Okay.
That will help.
So you did the cubes?
Yeah, I made the cubes earlier.
Something for you to help you?
Yes. And I'm going to make it again. Yeah. I'm going to make it again. But it's in a few steps from now. So as I move the slider around, nothing is happening here because I only have one pose. So I want, because it's a cycling animation, I want to have it end at the same pose that it started at. That's the first rule for cycling. So another interesting thing for me is the last frame in the action. And I'm going to somewhat arbitrarily say it's frame 41 because we started at frame 1, 40 frames later, it's frame 41. I can subdivide it and get different poses. And so we go back here and I'm going to select all of these channels. Shift over them. So you can shift select channels here and it will select multiple ones just like normal selection works. And I'm going to go to this header here and click on this down arrow here. The tooltip says copies the current pose to the buffer. So I'm going to copy this pose. And then I'm going to move the slider down to the frame that I want to be the last frame in the action. And I'm going to paste this pose. Now, nothing really happens. This is where maybe automatic keying could come in handy. But what I'm going to have to do here is create the keyframes. So I actually didn't have to copy the pose in this case, but normally you will. You will. Because it's the first action, you can just keyframe the current position, so it will do the exact same thing as what I did. But normally you copy it. So
copy Lakra and copy Lakra. Another way you can copy the codes, I'll show you another way. So now it's actually got a key thing here. Another way you can do it, I believe the things I just made, is I can select these, box select, same as normal, and you can do shift D here, same as normal. And I can drag them along. Now I want to hit control here because I want to constrain them to move on a one frame by one frame basis. I don't want them to be in fractional time because you want your keyframes to render exactly as they are typically. So you can see, you can actually see them on the screen. So we're going to go to 41 and drop it in here. So that's another way to copy it goes. So that's okay, that's great, but nothing's really moving yet. So we know that it's going to be an opposing action thing. So I'll copy this pose once again, and I'll go to the middle here, which is frame 21, and I'll do paste mirrored. And remember those dot L and dot R names? That's where they're going to help, because it's going to mirror the pose I had already. And then it's simply a matter of keying the right bone. So they all have rotation keys. I'm just going to add them right in the beginning just to help me out. And then I know that the feet have also location keys, and I know that the root has lockup. So now we have the skating thing, where he's skating between these two positions. And now we also have something more interesting to look at in the curve editor. Now you can see that there are these curves representing there's rotational data and there's location data in this case that we can see this. Now, this is okay, but as I'm walking on the work cycle, on my walk cycle, sorry, working on my walk cycle, I would like to see it sort of repeat, you know, like he's walking on a treadmill. I'm just taking one step. And so I'll select all of these curves. A, select all. It's the same as everywhere else in Blender. Most of the keys work the same way you select them to. So A is deselect all or select all, depending on whether you have a selection or not. So I'll select all the curves that pertain to this channel. Then I'll go curve, and I'll go extend mode, cyclic. And I'm going to repeat that. I don't think there's a way to avoid having to repeat it. Function. Okay. So I'm just going to do it all at once. I'm going to do it cyclic. Extend mode.
Can you do that in the action of the?
You can do an interpolation, but I don't think you want the extrapolation. Be nice and gentle. Because then you can select them all in here and change it. Now. The action will continue with this sort of cyclic extrapolation. And it looks like it missed this guy, right? Yeah, he's not moving at all. So, probably what happened. So I'm going to copy this guy's pose. I guess somehow I missed keying his keyframe right. So I'm just going to copy the current pose. I'm going to go here, select the mirror bone, paste it, and then I'm going to keyframe it. Oh wait. So we have an action that's cycling now, but it's not really a walk cycle yet.
but hit Alt A to run the animation, we'll see the field sliding. And so now we can start thinking of some other interesting poses that the walk goes through as we move. There's a pass position, obviously, where one of these feet is going to overtake. So the back foot here, instead of sliding forward, is actually going to have to step up and move forward. And so there are some interesting keyframes there. And so you can go somewhere in here, and I'm not going to get too technical about this, I'm just going to create one bone extra. And you can grab that bone and move it around. And you don't really need to lift it that much. Just lift it a little bit. And you can pre-frame right there. And that's a pass position for that bone. So now instead of sliding forward, it goes up forward. And I'm also going to say that when it's going up like that, I also kind of want most of the weight to shift from the bone that's here, for instance. Maybe give his hips an interesting rotation in one direction or another. Really up to me. So let's say I lift it just a little bit more. So that's my task.
I have a question right at that point the movements are not linear, they're kind of rounded. Is that a mode, I suppose, you can activate or deactivate?
The movements are not linear?
When you look at the eye pose, the rounded.
Oh, yes. The eye pose, the interpolation of the curves, you have three types.
Busy
you can
top.
Have busier, which is the default.
Yeah.
You can have linear, which puts straight lines between them. And you can also have constant, which basically jumps from one key position to the other. And actually, there's some very good character animators out there who advise that one technique of approaching character animation is to start out with constant interpolation. And the idea is the computer is doing no work for you at that point, and you see only what you've done. And then as you're working into it more and more, eventually you will turn on interpolation as a Bezier curve or something like that, depending on the program you're using. It's similar to if you're working with subdivision modeling, you might not turn on the smooth cage until relatively later in the modeling process. I usually work with the cage at first, and then after a few steps, it's later on that I actually turn on the smoothing. Because when you turn on the smoothing too early, it's going to melt your animation like butter. It would be all these curvy motions that you didn't really intend. Likewise, when you're modeling, all your hard edges disappear, and you get this melted wax kind of phenomenon until you add more detail to it. So you actually see closer to what you want in the early stages by having this kind of interpolation. But I'm not going to do that here because it doesn't look really nice. So we're going to go back. And it's not the perfect way to do things. I mean, it's one person's method, and other people might not use that method. So we're going to let the computer do the work for us here, actually. And so we have this pose, and he's stepping over. And here there's no stepping over. And so what I'm going to do is select the two bones that are doing work in this particular keyframe. And incidentally, I can hone this now that I've established the extent of the action. We can select the two bones that are relevant to this particular piece of animation. And I can go over to the sort of mirror pose and, oh, sorry, I don't just select them, I have to copy pose. And then I go over here and I hit. And I hit paste mirror and I unlock. And now I have two It's not really an important thing, so I'll just move it. So now we have something which looks sort of like a block cipher. And it doesn't look very good, and we're going to fix it up a little bit. But the arms are sort of walking the way they're supposed to, the thing is bouncing up and down somewhat, and the feet are sort of doing what we want, but not quite. They're not quite doing what we want, because we haven't finished yet. So let me... focus on the feet here. Let's see what they're doing now. One thing is, you'll notice that the foot that's on the ground is actually going below ground level a little bit along the length of its travel. So that's one thing it's doing now. And the other thing is not readily appearing right now. But I'm going to make it appear, and we're going to get to those cubes now. I'm going to pop out of this mode, and I'm going to put the cursor roughly where this foot is being run. I'm going to add a cube mesh.
And restrain it. So, it's
60s not done that actually producing. So I'll use roughly equally spaced. And so now I have my little helper object on my walk. And you can really see how messed up things are. So how do you fix that? Well, let's go back into the small side and go back into closed mode on this object. And let's select the foot that's now in front. As it's going backwards, it's doing this thing where it's dipping, and it's not moving at the exact same rate. It's not moving at the exact same rate as the cube. It's not moving linearly at all. It's moving this way non-linear rate. It would look worse, except it's separating from the curve. So, that's doing the curves work in that period of time. So here are its location information, which is doing. And you can see that they have curves. They have curve interpolation. And I just want to see this location key. I'm setting the location keys. So, you know, let's look at all curving all over the place. And that's not really good because it's not moving linearly back. And so, I'll show you two things here. And if you select points, and so I choose right click and left, right click, and shift select, select multiple ones, same as known. And you go in here, and you go into edit mode on the curves, the points on the curves that are relevant to that keyframe are automatically selected. But right now I don't care about the points themselves, I just care about the handles that are active on this zone here where the foot is on the ground. And I'm going to change the interpolation mode to linear. And that will fix that problem. Now, as long as that foot is on the ground, it's locked to its cube. So I just want the same thing to happen to this foot. And it's just relevant on a different part of the walk cycle. So I can select these points and change the curve interpolation mode to linear right here. You can mix interpolation mode to set for constant. It's on constant on one part of the curve, it has to be everywhere. But otherwise, you can make things linear in one part or not. So now. Oh, does it have all points selected?
No, I have to remember I called it on partial curve.
It'll work, yeah.
The entire curve of it is going to have partial energy, but it's three pieces of practice. And you have all these other parts.
Ah, yes. Okay. And what would
be easier to do? There was also an argument to make handle all the torsions.
See, I tried doing the menus because I didn't want to do things with hotkeys because you can't see what I'm doing. But okay, so we'll redo that.
Well, the problem would still work for this case, for example, I think the cycle.
Yeah, actually, the cycle would look okay, but I'm glad that you noticed that. So actually, I'm going to select all the curves in the rotation ones that I'm going to do. Select the handles in and hit the new key. That's how I normally do it, but I thought that I would be more visible with menus. But, so now it's sort of decent. You know, the walk cycle is not a very nice walk cycle, but it's a walk cycle. And it will work on the app. And the other cool thing about it is figuring out the stride length. How much of the distance is this character covering? And you kind of have to get a calculator out in a way. I mean, because it's got to be fractional. But you can at least see the numbers you have to subtract. If you pull up the N key here, and you can see where the mean is on this axis, and then select these guys. And subtract the two numbers, and you would get the total distance of travel during the walk. And should we do that? I should do that. So Okay, so. So I guess I'll wrap up the official part of this soon, and maybe I'll be around for the rest of the conference with my computer with this demo on it. You can go downstairs at some point and people can ask me questions.
I would go back and talk to the
So, I mean, that won't, I won't actually do the calculation for the strike length anymore, but basically, if you stick it on a map and you type in the right number in that little pop up menu, and we'll just go back to our pre existing guy here. Let's go to this screen that has the right windows there. So, you'll see that this pop up menu has the strike length value. If you type it in, then those points where the foot is on the ground with the red slope, it will automatically not slip through, and you'll have no feet slipping during this action. Pretty much that's all that's tricky going on in this action. Up to you.
A stride would be the length of the total animation before it loops, or does it assign that automatically?
It's the total action. So how much distance does it cover over the action? And it doesn't have to be a walking character, it could be a rolling ball. Right. It could be a rolling ball. And if you did a complete turn, then the stride length would be the circumference of that ball, right? So it could be any kind of thing that you want. If you want sliding, you can change this number here and it will slide. And you might have an ice skating animation or something like that, and you might want the feet to slide a little bit.
It only works on the top.
Yeah. So you walk along this path. The only tricky thing here to show you really briefly, because we ran out of time, and I was going to show how to do it, and we finished it because it was difficult. You can look at the path. The path has an angle curve as well, and that represents how fast and in how many frames this character traverses the entire path. And you'll notice that there's a sort of a dead spot here where it doesn't move on the path. And that's where I was blending between two actions. And briefly what I did, very briefly what I did, is I have a walk and then have a leap, or a, really a run action here that I had done previously. And to blend in between them, I wanted them to sort of scrunch down and then leap up. And I wanted to do the scrunch action in place. He's not actually moving when he's getting ready to leap. And so I killed the verticality, made it a zero slope there on that curve. And then in between those two points, I made a new action that sort of blends the last pose of the walk with the first pose of the leap. And you can do those copy-paste poses between different actions, even between different armatures, so long as they have the same names for the bones. And so, another wrinkle added to this, which I'm going to have to explain, and I really want to show some people, coders I want to show later on, to show how hard it is to do this now, because it should be really easy. But you have to kind of play around a little bit to get the, to make that action in a way that still is intuitive to you. Yes?
There's no possibility to kind of like do a busy or a smooth automatic blend between two actions in the NLA?
Well, you can. You can blend the actions. But if you have an action with a feet position, with a foot position, you know, turn my arm with the foot here, and the other action footstep is here, as you blend, the foot's going to skate between those two positions. Oh. So you need to pin that bone somewhere. To make it sort of start and end at the same point. So if you do a smooth blend between the two things, which you can't, you can do a linear blend. You can do a linear blend in the NLA. If you do a linear blend, it will linearly move from point A to point B and it will skate and it won't look right. But you can lock it. There are ways to lock that thing down. The way you do that is the penultimate, the really final way to do that is to use constraints, because you can basically hijack the last pose of the first action and the first pose of the last. The first pose of the last action must be right. So the poses between the two blended actions, you can hijack those terminal poses by putting an empty down where you want the foot to be when you're blending. And so you don't let it go to its normal footstep. You animate the constraint to that empty. You can animate constraints just like anything else. So instead of stepping to where it normally would have, it steps to the empty. Instead of starting where it normally would have, it starts out from the empty. And then you fade out the influence of that constraint. And so now you block that ball. So in addition to having to make a mixing action, which has its own kind of challenges to do it in an intuitive way in Blender, you also have to make an animated constraint. And very quickly, the way to intuitively do a mixing action is you have to copy the whole armature and apply the action to that. So you can get around the limitations of the NLA. Is that if you have an active action that you're editing, it supplants all your NLA animation, becomes invisible. So if you want to see its effect within the NLA, you have to edit it on a different armature than the one that has the NLA channel. And then you can edit the action line and see its effect on the object that's in the NLA. Otherwise, your whole NLA action will disappear, all the walk cycles will disappear. They're still there, they're not gone for good, but you can't see them anymore until you make the action on an NLA strip. But you can't edit an NLA strip. So you have to do it this kind of funky way, where you copy the armature and you edit the action on the copy of the armature. So that's how I did the blend action there, is I basically copied the poses from the two actions, and I pasted them onto the new action that was in a totally different armature. It was just in the same position that the primary armature is. And then I added that action as an action strip right here. And then I edited the other armature so I could see a change on the one I'm really interested in this case. And so that's how you get around that sort of limitation. The other thing is that constraints, while you can visualize them in actions, you cannot blend them in the NLA. Even though you see them in the action and they look like they're part of the action, they're sort of kind of not. And so notice that there's this action here called constrainer. And all my animated constraints have to be in that top level action. It won't supplant anything, because there are no constraint keys to be supplanted in the other actions. And so it just does the constraining. And where it's useful for me is in the very beginning of the action, where it's blending here. See, that's that intermediate bone, that empty constraint that's faded in and out. And at the very end, when he steps on the last one and he falls, I pin his foot to an empty that's on the top of the last pillar, so I can move the pillar around and his foot moves with it, you know, to extend the convenience there. So those are the two cases there. So you have to keep the constraint keys in a separate action all the time and apply it at the top level.
So what you're doing now is that you're not changing the skeleton, you're just changing the bones at a certain point in the NLA.
Right.
And you're kind of like weighting the way the bones influence, or are there two sets of bones on top of one another at a point?
The two skeletons are independent of each other.
Yeah.
It's just that I want to edit my action live. You know, I want to see what it's doing within the context of being mixed on the NLA.
Oh, yeah.
But there's actually no way of doing that on the same armature. So you just have to make a copy of the armature, apply the action to it, and now you can edit the copy. And it's kind of like if you're modeling with linked meshes, you know, if you do mirror modeling and you're modeling the left side and seeing the effects on the right side, it's kind of like that because you have two objects sharing the same data.
Yeah.
Right? But they're sharing it in a different way. One of them uses that data as an NLA strip, and one of them has it as an active action that you can edit live. And so that's how you do it.
One last question. That's very much, I guess, how you copy and paste action when you delete the armature that belongs to it, right?
Right.
You said you have two actions by default.
Right.
And you
the action
once, and when you want to have a library of actions, you take.
Right. The action can have multiple users, right? So when I have two armatures that the action is applying to, it theoretically has only two users. But what I said was about the extra user. It's there because if an action only has zero users, if a piece of data has no users, it doesn't save it with the file. And because...
It's actually a giant flaw. It's actually a professional flaw.
And so it just adds in. But it actually, from a practical perspective of a user, it works beautifully. It doesn't fail you. You know, it doesn't not save the action. It works very nice. It just has an extra number there, you know, that you don't have to worry about too much.
When you use the armature, it's like having these meshes and you don't limit all the times of the text. Is it possible that your simple armature looks pretty complex to me? Like, there's a lot of constraints. It's pretty complex to me. Is it possible, for example, that you would have like templates that you would have like a male figure? Is it possible to subdivide it all so that you like tweak it to my model and not start with nothing?
You can't subdivide, but you can join armatures together. So you can take an existing armature and you can add to it, or you can take two armatures. Let's say you have an arm template and a leg template, join those and make one armature out of them. But you can extrude. There's an extrude operation on bone, and it basically makes a linked child. But you can't take a bone that's one piece and say, okay, I want to make it into two small bones. There's no function like that in editing. It would be kind of cool. But I haven't seen it in other. My only prior animation experience is Animation Master. And so when I know the other way of doing animation, it's only the Animation Master way of doing it. I used to use Studio Max's work a long time ago, but I didn't do much animation in it.